7, chapter number 2, verse number 25. This is Hiranyakashipu giving a philosophical lecture to his family members. Philosophy is very useful tool if you want to impress others, and especially if you want to change the mind of people, it is a very good instrument. So Hiranyakashipu, although on one side he ordered his followers to go and destroy everything on earth, destroy the Brahmanas, destroy yagyas, put fire to the cities and villages, cut the trees, kill the cows. But now he's saying that the Atma is never killed. It is eternal, conscious, all-pervading, all-knowing, and without any modifications. So why he is interested then in killing? And therefore he should not lament for the death of my brother Hiranyaksha. He was a great hero and he died a very wonderful death fighting with enemy. And this is the greatest or glorious death for a hero, to die fighting. Sometimes sadhus in Vrindavan they say that glorious death is by eating prasad. They say that you eat, and go on eating till you die. Khamat khamat chutai sarira tabhai milai siya raghuvira. That if you die while eating, then you meet Lord Rama and Sita. Because in Ramanandi Sampradaya, one of the biggest spiritual activities is doing bhandaras, feasts. Wherever there is Ramanandi ashram, you will see every day bhandara. They are very fond of feeding people. So that is spiritual, because prasad is spiritual. And if you eat and die while eating, where will you go? You'll go to the spiritual world and eat prasad. Because Krishna says whatever is the consciousness and the time of death, that's what you attain. Right? So it makes sense. So this is the easy route. And who does not like eating? So like that, he says that the hero is glorious if he dies on the battlefield. Krishna also says this in Bhagavad Gita. Says there are two types of people who are glorious. One is a sannyasi, other is kshatriya, who fights for dharma. So we read his instructions. So at least it is good to change the mind. Because when somebody is sad, somebody is depressed, then you have to change their awareness, their consciousness. Then they will start working.
Modern psychology, they also call it framing.
Hmm?
In modern psychology, they also call it framing, like how you frame a particular event.
Yes. So, reality is manifest at many levels. So, a person is sad at one level, he changes his level, then maybe his sadness will go. So, therefore, he says, Esha Atma Viparyaso Hiyalinga Linga Bhavana Esha priya priya yoga, vyoga karma samsriti. So he says that this atma viparyas, that there is a change or switch in consciousness of atma because of maya. And we saw previously. So maya vishvajan kunam. And what is the viparyas? Viparyas means illusion. And this is the illusion for Atma. What is the illusion? Alingai linga bhavana. That which is not the body, to think that it is my body. So this physical body is not the body of Atma. But to consider this is my body, this is illusion. And this is the basic disease. So if you want to become healthy, this is the disease. All other diseases arise from this basic disease. So therefore philosophy is the only solution. Panacea. They call it Rambam. So this is the solution for all diseases, philosophy. So, if one can understand that body, this physical body is not myself, then one is situated in one's own self. So, mukti ritva anitha rupam swarupena vyavasthiti. So, mukti means to become situated in your own self by giving up this attachment to body, etc. Esha priya priya yoga vyoga karma sanskriti. Says once you have this consciousness of body, then this is my body, then you naturally come in contact with certain things which you like and other things which you don't like. Simple. Because as far as Atma is concerned, there is no such thing as for Atma that these material objects are good or bad. But you like one type of food, you don't like another type of food. You like one type of music, you don't like another type. You like one type of association, you don't like. But Atma is immaterial to these things. It doesn't have any effect on Atma. So he says only when, because of this linga bhavana, this bodily consciousness, then we have this idea. Then this is Priya and this is Apriya. Likeable and not likeable. And Vyoga Karma, Vyoga Karma Sanskriti. And because of our karma, then we naturally come in contact with certain things which we like, certain things which we don't like. And we also have naturally separation from things which we like. And union with things which we don't like. And that's how our life continues. Sometimes happy, sometimes sad. So, chakravat parivartam te sukhani cha dukhani cha. Like the ferry wheel. You sit in it, sometimes you are up, sometimes down, sometimes then again up, then down. So our life goes on rotating like a ferry wheel. Sometimes happy, sometimes sad. Sometimes healthy, sometimes sick. Sometimes energetic, sometimes feeling weak. So this happens by the law of karma. We eat food which everyone is eating, you get diarrhea, no one else gets it. You wonder why I did it. So not everybody gets diarrhea in the same food. But somebody gets it. So this is karma sanskriti. This is how karma is there. Of course you must say that immunity is this, that. So he says, alinga api atmani ling bhavana dehabhimana. So he says that Atma has no body. Atma is no body. so far. Just a small spark. But feel so proud. People say, oh, I'm so strong, I'm so tall, I'm so muscular. So all these type of things because of the body only. When the body is made of gunas, those who are muscular, if they get diarrhea for 2 days, then they also. One day I was reading in the newspaper, there was this interview with this Arnold
Schwarzenegger.
What is his second name? I cannot pronounce
it. Schwarzenegger.
So something.
Black guy.
Something. So he was supposed to be Mr. Universe 7 times. And now he was saying that when I see myself in front of the mirror, then I wonder what is happening to me. So his body is shrinking with age. So one day he may be lying in a cot actually, or in a wheelchair. So that much for the body. So if you identify with it, then you suffer. So that's, he says, Dehabhimana. This attachment to body. Abhimana means measuring. I measure myself according to the body. Body big, I am big. Body small, I am small. Body weak, I am weak. This is called Abhimana. So like you have Parimana, size. This is also the word Abhimana. In English you call it pride. So we ride on the pride. Sanskrit words are very nice, Abhimana. Esa eva atmano viparyasa viparyaya. So this is the viparyaya. Viparyaya means opposite. What to feel, what one is not. Tasmadeva atmana esa priya apriya yoga viyogasya chakarad viparitasya. So then you have yoga and viyoga. So people are doing yoga these days. So this is yoga also happening. You are all the time having yoga and viyoga. Meeting somebody and separation from someone. So our life is full of yoga and viyoga. And apriya yoga, priya viyoga. So you meet good things and separation from bad things. And then you meet bad things, separation from good things. So this is sansriti. This is called sansriti. Samsara. So Sri Dhatu. Like you know the word serpent. Comes from the same sarva, Sri, that which keeps on slipping. So sansara means which is slipping away. Everything you have is slipping away from you. Your life, your body, your age, every day, every moment, it's slipping away. Your hair are slowly turning grey, now you feel happy with them, but you don't know that behind. They are slowly turning grey, slipping. That is sanskrit. So nana garbhesu pravesha. And then you keep on moving from one birth to another birth. So that is, so that's why he says, why you have to worry and cry? This is natural consequence. Sambhavascha vinashascha shokascha vividha smritaha avivekascha chintacha viveka smriti revascha. So because of this deyabhiman, this identification with the body, then he says sambhava, there is creation and vinasha, there is destruction, and shoka, there is lamentation, sadness, and vividha smrita. All these varieties come. Everybody experiences these things. Because everybody is identifying with the body. So it is unavoidable. And avivekascha chintascha viveka smriti revascha. And then sometimes we have avivek. We don't know what decision is to be taken. We are confused. So no light in the head. Unable to decide. and chinta, anxiety. And sometimes you have vivek, sometimes you make good decisions. And asmriti, sometimes you forget things. Things which you, the people with whom you deal, sometimes their name you cannot remember. An old man was speaking with his friend. He said that these days I am attending a session with my therapist, and he is teaching me how to boost up memory. He is talking about associations, how to improve your memory, associate things to remember. And then, like that he was saying, so then he asked that, what did you study yesterday? So his wife was standing, sitting next to him. So he forgot what he studied. So he was asking his wife. So then he asked his friend that, do you know that flower, you know that flower which has thorns and the leaves fall very quickly? So he said, rose. He said, yes, yes. He says, Rosie, what did we study? So this is association. You don't have to remember the name. So he says, sometimes it happens, asmriti also, you forget even the common things. Sometimes a sloka, you recite every day and suddenly it doesn't come to your mind. So this is called asmriti. So vivekasya satopi asmriti rasakriti. So even when you have viveka, you cannot remember things. So atrapi udharanti umam itihasam puratanam yamasya prayata bandhunam samvadantam vibodhata. Now best way to instruct is by telling stories. If you want to teach somebody something, don't just talk philosophy. You should also tell stories. And then inside the story bring philosophy. So this is very effective way of teaching. Not like nyayam. So that's not the way. So Bhagavatam therefore tells stories. So Hiranyakashipu, he also knew this. He was an intelligent person. So he knows that all these people are now crying for their father or husband or son, because his nephews were there, the wife of his brother, and his mother was there. So he first speaks philosophy, says if I tell them story, everybody will hear very eagerly, because people like to hear stories. So he says in this regard, people speak of one very old story. And I'm going to tell you the story. And the story is where Yamaraj, the Lord of Death, he has a dialogue with the relatives of a king who died on the battlefield. So you please hear this very carefully. Because same thing, what has happened to these people, same thing happened to somebody else. When something happens to you, and if you tell it directly to instruct you directly, then you don't like it. You tell it to somebody or about someone else, then you hear very carefully. That's what Krishna is doing. There was no problem with Arjuna. Arjuna is his friend. So he said, Arjuna, now act. Because if I tell to people that you are all in bodily concept of life, you are in confusion, you are in maya, and you are all ignorant fools, then they will become upset. Right? He's actually telling it to us. Arjuna had no problem. Arjuna is friend of Krishna. Krishna is driving a chariot. How can you have a problem? He said, just now let's play, make a show. So this is the time. So Arjuna immediately started trembling. He said, how can I fight with my guru? He already fought with his guru. He Bhishma, everybody, he has already fought with them when they were living incognito. All these people came to steal cow and Arjuna fought with them alone. So now he says, how can I fight with them? So Krishna, of course at that time Krishna was not there. It was not time to speak Bhagavad Gita. Now in front of everybody, he starts talking. So he is his friend, he wants to teach, give this knowledge for humanity. This is his compassion. So Arjuna is put into the body. You give instruction to your own friend and then everybody will read about Arjuna. Not knowing that actually Arjuna is I myself. First chapter of Arjuna, not the second chapter. So we are all first chapter Arjunas. And same difficulties he was having. So therefore you tell story. That's why people like to hear stories about others. Because it's not about them. But all the stories here in Bhagavatam, they are only to teach us, we are the ones who have these problems. Whether it is Hiranyakashipu or Hiranyaksha or other, all these problems exist inside us. And they have to be taken out through these stories. And it's a nice way. So now if he goes on telling this to the relatives, they will think what he thinks of us. He thinks he is so great that he knows and we don't know. So therefore he switches on to story. He says, Praita Bandhunam Samvadam Tam Nivodhya. He says there was a very nice dialogue of Yamaraj. And of course Yamaraj is telling something, it must be good. So he says, please pay attention to this. So atrapi asochyasyapi shoke itihasamati. So he says here, in this regard you are lamenting for that which you should not lament. And Krishna says asochyanam asochyastvam pragyavadasya bhashase. So don't grieve for that which is not worthy of grief, and these people were doing that. So he says, in this regard there is a story about a dead fellow and his relatives. So please pay attention. Kushi Nareshva Bhud Raja Suyagyeti Vishrutaha Sapatne Nihito Yudhe Gyati Astan Upasata. He says that in the land of Kushinara, a country called Kushinara, there was a king whose name was Suyagya. He says, we have heard this. And when he was living there, he was a nice king, very generous, loving, kind, compassionate to his people. He was married. He had a few kings and children and family. And one day a neighboring king attacked him. So this was a problem in the olden days. Kings didn't have much to do. So they gather army and then they want to expand their kingdom. They will fight. So there was a fierce fight. And unfortunately or fortunately, the king, this Suyagya, he got killed. So Sapatnair Nihito Yuddhe Gyati Astam Upasata. So Sapatni means enemy, the enemy they killed him in the battle. And then when he died, then his relatives, they came near his dead body. And they have to do the ceremony, Daha Samskar, burning the body. So when they saw him, then they started crying because he was in a very bad situation. Before dying, obviously, he did not die some comfortable death. He was smashed by the arrows. So he says, Vishirna Ratna Kavacham Vibhrashta Abharana Srajam Saranirbhinna Hridayam Shyanam Ashrigamana. That is armor. Previously they used to wear this armor when the fight was face to face. So he had a very nice armor, and being a king, his armor was also studded with gems. In India previously there were a lot of gems. So they would use them to decorate themselves in their helmet and their whatever ornaments. So he said it was completely torn. And we brushed Abhinan, all his ornaments, they were thrown away. And Swajam, also his garland was broken. And the king used to wear garlands, so the garland was also smashed. And Saranirbhin Hridaya, his heart was tore open by the sharp arrows. And he had short arrows at his chest. It cut through the armor and pierced into his heart. All the blood came out and he died. So Shayana Mashrigamana, he was lying down on the ground full of blood. Because so much blood came out of his body because the heart tore. And Prakirna Keshad Dhastaksham Rabasad Dashta Dachadam. And his hair were disheveled and his eyes had sunken inside. And out of anger he was biting his lips, as was also described about Hiranyaksha. So same here, because these people, they were fighting, they were very angry. Hiranyakashipu was also biting his lips out of anger. So he also, before dying, he must have been very angry at the enemy. And then when he died suddenly, then he died in the same posture. His teeth biting the lips. And Rajaha Kunta Mukham Bhojam Chinna Ayudha Bhojam Vidhe. And his lotus face, beautiful face, was covered with dust. And he was fighting on the horses. And all his weapons, Chinnayudha Bhujam, his arm was cut by the weapon. So he was lying down in the battlefield. So this was his situation. Naturally, the relatives see this, how they feel. Ravsa krodhena dashto dachada adharo yena. So out of anger, he was biting his lips. Tam tatakshanam eva sapatni shastra hatatvat tatha bhutatvene mritvati shtitamati. So he says that when he was angry at the enemy and he was biting his lip, out of anger at that time only, the enemy hit him and he got killed. So that's how he was lying down. So then his wives came and they were crying. Ushi Narendram Vidina Tathakritam Patim Mahishyata Samisha Dukhita Atasmanateti Karai Guru Bhrisham Gnanteo Muhtat Padio Ratapatam. So the queens, he must have few queens, so they all, when they came and they saw their husband lying dead, Ushi Narendra, Vidina Tathakritam, by the luck or fate. So prasamiksha dukhita, by seeing that, they became very, very sad. And hatasme natheti karai guru prasam. And by seeing this, they say, oh, we are dead, we are killed, we are finished, like people say, I am finished. Right? Even when somebody is alive, says, I am finished. So they also said like this, and then they were beating their chest with their hands. And muhus tatpadiyo papata. Again and again they were beating their chest with their hands out of sadness, and then they fell on the ground near to the feet of their husband and started lamenting. Rudatya chair dat daitang ripankajam sinchantya shrei kuchikum kumarunehi nishrastakesha bharana sucham nirnam sijanta akandana yavilepire. So they were crying in a very piteous manner, and what they were doing is that because they were next to the feet, so the tears were flowing from their eyes and they were falling on their breast, and from that they are falling onto the feet of the husband. And in the past there was a custom of putting kumkum on the breast. So the kumkum was getting mixed with their tears, and then these red tears, they were going to the feet as if they were doing the avishek on the tears. And vishrasta kesha bharana susham nirnam sujante akrandanaya vilekin. So their hairs were also disheveled because obviously they must be shaking their head out of sadness. And sujante akrandanaya vilekin. And this way they were causing sadness to everyone around. Even women, they cry, then anyone who sees them, they also feel like crying. And they cry very loudly. So he says, Nisrijante Akrandanaya. Akrandanaya means crying, loud crying. And thus they were speaking, trying to vent out their sadness. अहो विधात्रा करुणेन न प्रभो भवान प्रणीतो दृगगोचरान दशान निशुनरामसी वृत्तिदपुरा कुतो धनायेन शुचां विवर्धना. So they said that Vidhata is word used for one who writes the fate. Brahma is also called Vidhata. So whoever he may be, so they are blaming the fate, actually their fate, but they are saying that one who wrote our fate is very cruel to us. Why is that? Aho Vidhatra Anukarane Naya Prabhu. Because he has taken away our Lord from our eyes. Now he is not visible to us. And previously one who was maintaining the whole kingdom and was the cause of happiness, now he is increasing the sadness of all people. And everybody loved the king, and now he is gone. So vilapa maha ahoti. So he describes their lamentation, how they are lamenting. प्रणीतो गमितः येन विधात्रा तेन घनाम् उसी नराणाम् सुचाम् विवर्धनः कृतोऽसि. So it says that the husband has been taken away, the king, and therefore this has become the cause of sadness for the whole kingdom. त्वया कृतज्ञेन वयम् महीपते कथम विनाश्याम सुहितमेन ते तत्रानुयानं तव वीरपादयो शुश्रूषतीनां दशयत्रयास्यसि. Said that, O hero, you are very kritagya. Kritagya means ingrate, the person who is very grateful to others what they do. He said that you are a very grateful person because we did little service to you, and you will feel very happy and appreciate that. Now how can we live without you? You are most dear to us, Vaitama. So tatra niyanam tavira padiyo sushrushati nam jasayas. You want to follow you or dear husband. So please tell us so that we can also come where you have gone. Yatra tvam yasi tatra te aniyanam anugamnam tav padiyo sushrushanartham. Where you have gone, we also want to follow you so that we can continue our service to your feet. Disha dehi vayamipi miryamahi kyaps. So allow us to come to you, which means that allow us that we also kill ourselves. So many times in India, the wives, queens, they used to burn themselves alive in the burning body of the husband, because they could not tolerate the separation. So evam vilapti nam vai parigrahi amritam patim anichyati nam nirharam arko astam samyavartata. So when their wives, these queens, they were lamenting like this, surrounding the dead body of the husband, and they did not allow him to be taken away for burning, because body has to be burned before the sun sets. When someone dies, otherwise we have to wait for next day, that is the custom. So, but they did not allow anichyati nam nirharam. Nirharam means the action of burning the body. So in the meantime, the sun went down. So nirharam dahartham nayanam astam astachalam praptam yavartat chalanam vittayam shantayam. So they did not allow people to take the dead body, and therefore the sun stopped his movement or means set. Tatraha preta bandhunam ashrutya paridevitam ahatana balako bhutva yamaha swayam upagataha. So then when Lord of Death Yamaraj, he heard all these relatives crying, wailing, lamenting like this, then he came there in the form of a young boy. And he spoke to them as follows. So Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur, he gives nice conjecture on this, that why Yamaraj has to come there. What was the need for Yamaraj to come? So he says, Swayam upagata iti punyavat jivanam nirharanta eva yampur gamnam praya sambhavati tikechi. He says different people have given different understanding why Yamaraj came. So Yamaraj is not an ordinary person. So many people die every day. There is no need for him to come. So he says that those people who are very pious, they can reach the city of Yamaraj only when their body has been burnt. If their body is not burnt, then they still remain here. And therefore, he wanted that this person comes to his place and he will meet out his fate, his next destination. But because they were not allowing the body to be burnt, so therefore Yamaraj has to come there to preach to them, to leave the dead body. So this is one understanding. So some people will say like it. Tasameva madhye kashyachid vaishnava striha tatsamip adi yamdutai netum ashakyatvat tatsamipat tatsamipya durikarnartham swayam yamayev agata. Some people give another explanation. The explanation is that maybe one of the queen of this king was a devotee, Vaishnava. And the Yamdutas, they cannot approach Vaishnavas. They don't have the power. We already read this in 6th canto, how they got chastised by the Vishnu Dutas when they came to take Ajamil. And then they got a big warning from Yamaraj, who said that now in future never ever approach the Vaishnava. He says, if you see a Vaishnava, just leave alone. So therefore he says that Kashyachir Vaishnava Sriyatat Samipadma. Some woman must be Vaishnava. And obviously the king was not. That's why he is to be taken. So Yamduta did not have any power to go there. And they went and told this to Yamaraj. And look, there is this devotee lady sitting there crying for her husband. So we don't know what to do. So Yamaraj said, okay, you relax. This I have to take care of myself. So therefore he personally came to separate the devotee from there and give a lecture so that she goes away. And then Yamdutas can carry the Atma or the Jiva from the body. So he said this, some people give this explanation. So nice. So Balako Bhutva Anyesham Tatra Pravesh Asamartha. So why did he become a boy? Should have come also as a grown-up person. So he says anyone else would not have been allowed there. After all, he was a king and queens were there. So grown-up person will not be allowed because queens, they cannot be approached by anybody like that. But if you become a small boy, nobody will stop you. So maybe the other people were a little far away. And that's why they were just waiting that they will go away and they take the body for cremation. So he became a young boy so that he could reach them. That is one reason. Second reason is Bala Bhashitasya Madhuratva. He says if some grown-up person gives some lecture, that is not so attractive if some young fellow gives. They say, oh, such a small boy, he is speaking so nicely. So these days we have what is called Bala Vyasa. You heard Bala Vyasa? Vyasa, you know, right? Vyasa, Bhagavatam. So these people who do Bhagavat Kathas, Bhagavat Sapta, the 7-day recitation of Bhagavatam, they are also called Vyasa. Because they are like Vyasadeva. They sit on the Vyasasana and they speak. So they are called Kathavyas. And these days there are young boys doing it. 10-year-old, 10-12-year-old boy. Girl, 2-3 girls are also there. So they are called Bala Vyas, means baby Vyas. So because, and people listen to them. Because to hear young boy, 12-year-old boy speaking in Bhagavatam, it's very attractive. So therefore it says Bala Bhasitasya Madhuratva. It's like if you have your own children and they are small and they speak something, then that's very pleasing. Parents feel so happy. It's only when they grow up and they start talking too much, then they say, keep shut. One man, he was saying that, I did not know that. Till I was 12 years old, I didn't know that shut up was not my name. So that is the other reason. Tat kartritattva kathanasya ati vishmaya avahatva. This is when a small young boy speaks, then it is very surprising for people that how this small boy knows so much. Therefore, people become very attentive to hear. So, tattva jigriksha utpadam samarthyatva. And thus, he says that the boy has the ability to create the desire to hear and accept what is being said. So that is the reason. That's why when Sukhdeva Goswami came, so many great sages were sitting when Parikshit was there. Right? Even Parashara Vyasa's father was there, Narada Vyasa, and so many other Chavan, Vasishtha, great, great people were sitting in that assembly. Jambalya, Parshuram. So, but when Sukhdeva came and everybody listened to him, he was the youngest. They were all senior people. And then what Sukhdev said was very wonderful. So that's Bhagavatam, very great. Spoken by young fellow. Only written by Vyasa. So that's, he said, that is the reason that he became a young boy. So now he is going to speak. He will give a big lecture to them. And very logically, he will talk to them. And by hearing their talk, his logic and his tattva katha, his philosophy, and then they will stop crying. And they will go on. So that we will read day after tomorrow. Tomorrow is first thing, there is no class. Is there any question?
So you were saying that philosophy is the best means for all solution, including health.
Is the thing?
Huh? Yeah. But when you say that, like this, or when Bhagavatam says to disidentify with the body, does that mean that we don't take care of the body?
No. It's like you know that you are not the car, but doesn't mean you don't take care of the car. Right?
Yeah.
You know that you are not the room, but you keep it clean.
Sometimes they don't take care of the body, they transcend it.
That is a little bit of ignorance. You just like you don't want to clean your room. There's nothing philosophical about not cleaning your room. You live in it.
Does being philosophical in the true sense also depend on grace? Or is it really just limited to the bhakti element?
Well, ultimately everything depends on grace. Because our principle is, Bhagavatam has a principle which says that there is ultimately one reality. When it says one reality, Advaya Gyan, means that one reality is the source of everything and cause of everything. So if you accept that, then ultimately yes, it depends on His grace. So again, as we said, that it's a question from which angle you see things, from which level. So if you see only from tattva point of view, then yes. Then you come to the vyavaharika point of view, empirical level, then we have our actions and decisions, our practice, all these things.
Because we see in the world that So many people go through so much suffering, they never question it, they never become philosophical about it.
So that's why this verse will come, soon Prahlad speaks this. Matir na krishna svatar parto svatarva. That this philosophical inclination means this awareness of Krishna, say, does not happen by one's own effort or even by hearing from others. Says Mahatpala Rajo Vishekam. Only when you get the grace of a great devotee of the Lord, then it happens. So he also talks about grace. Yoga Swami also, when he does this analysis of bhakti, his conclusion is only sadhu sang. That is the ultimate cause.
So when Krishna says in the Gita, Manushyanam Sahasrishu Paschitya Tatisitai, that it seems like it's an evolutionary progress. You gradually come to it by the things that happen to you or by your endeavor. What is actually the dynamics to become philosophical?
No, dynamic is this only, that you have association with someone, and by the influence of that association you become jigyasu, inquisitive. So that is the beginning. You just get some inner curiosity or desire to know this. And that inspires you to take the second action. Let me now find someone who can tell me, teach me, and learn. So that's, and it grows from there. And the beginning point is always some association. So it's the influence of that association which instills inquisitiveness.
So there is a correlation between becoming philosophical and preaching?
Preaching?
You said by association.
Well, Prahlad also said that it does not happen by your own effort or by someone's preaching. So it is by the grace of a person who is qualified for that. That's what is Bhagavatam's view. So many people also preach. Some people don't accept. They don't take to it.